Australia has long been blessed with stable governments, high-functioning democracy, and the rule of law. However, what actively enables the flourishing of our society is not just government and its agencies, or even our local communities, but the for-purpose sector. While the retail sector facilitates vitally needed communities of interaction, and our diverse local suburbs for many are communities of belonging, it is the charities and not-for-profits that build communities of purpose. These for-purpose organisations are defined by three factors which distinguish them from business, retail, or local communities. They're problem-focused, outward-orientated, and action-driven. This is why people, even in this era of declining trust in institutions, continue to hold charities in high regard. So joining me today to discuss the insights from our latest report about the future of the not-for-profit sector is Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ashley. Great to be discussing this important topic with you.
We have been conducting this research as an organisation annually for a number of years, for as long as I've been at McCrindle. I know that you've got a passion for this sector and a lot of our team do as well. How did this research or this passion come about for you? How did it all originate?
Well, because charities and not-for-profits are really interested in staying relevant, in adapting to the times, in understanding their communities, they've come to us for a long period. For more than 10 years, we've been running this national research into charities and supporting them even longer than that with our analysis. So it's an important sector. And as you said in the introduction, charities do what businesses don't do. You know, it's not about an exchange of money. Charities meet needs that can never be commercially solved. And charities do what governments can't do because they are connected with their local communities. They've got the trust of those local communities and they're spread very broadly and doing a range of things. I mean, in this analysis, and if you look at the Not-for-Profits Commission, it shows that charities in Australia are engaged in 845 different program classifications. So that's a lot of different work. There are more than 50,000 charities in Australia alone. You're operating most of them at a very small level, micro scale, but meeting the needs of their local community. The majority or the largest proportion of faith-based organizations, local churches and faith communities. You've got education in that second big category, meeting the needs of local students in their area. You've got groups meeting the needs of their local cultural needs or sporting needs across the landscape of this nation. Others that are meeting the needs of children and youth. They're the biggest beneficiaries of charities in Australia are young people. You've got those meeting the needs of animal welfare, of the environment, of supporting people in housing and financial distress, raising awareness of so many different issues. And so that's what all the charities do that could not be met in terms of that diversity and that local connection by either the for-profit world or the government sector. And that's why they're so important. And that's why being relevant matters so much. And that's why we are out in what we do to support them through our analysis.
Yeah, I think it's such a really great part of our purpose statement. You know, we exist to empower human flourishing and we do a lot of different work at McCrindle for a lot of different sectors, but we work a lot in with this sector and I know it really does fulfill a lot of our purpose and our team feel a real connection to a lot of the charities and not-for-profits that we have the privilege of helping understand their donor base or even the external environment, sort of shaping the trends and helping them remain relevant because for so many, we do believe in the good work that they do and a lot of these organizations helping people who are vulnerable or doing some great work in society. So it's a real privilege for many of our team to be working in those specific sort of charities or not-for-profits that we get to do work for, but also this kind of sector-wide study, which we hope is a real blessing to people who are doing a lot of hard work on the front line of these organizations, but also, I guess, at the strategy level and ensuring their organizations remain relevant into the future. Within this report, we have, of course, included an infographic sort of summary at the start, as we like to do, to bring the insights to life and a lot of statistics to communicate those in an engaging way. There's this really great sort of landscape page, kind of setting the context around the charities and not-for-profit sector, which I've got open in front of me. And I wanted to ask, Mark, what stood out to you from this particular page where we painted this picture of a lot of insights about, say, the number of charities or, you know, revenue insights? What stood out to you from this really engaging snapshot?
Well, Firstly, it's just the scale of the charity sector. You know, people might know of a charity that they support. We could maybe list off three or four that come to our mind that are big brand name charities that do some great work. But the fact that there are 50,000 charities operating in Australia, the fact that most charities will run more than one program, so that's more than 100,000 different programs being run across this nation. They employ more than 1.5 million Australians. We just don't think about charities as a major backbone of employment in this nation, but it turns out they're the biggest employers, biggest sector of Australians to be working in. More than one in 10 Australians is working in a charity. That's more than work in retail or in hospitality or in manufacturing. So they're massive in the employment side. And more than 3.5 million people volunteer for charities in the last year. So they are not just paying people, but they're receiving a lot of hard work as we volunteer for these local organisations and see them do great work. So probably the size of the sector is the first thing. The second thing that stood out to me is that actually it's at the smaller end that we see so much good stuff. And again, we tend to think about the large charities that are so well known and they do some great things, but we probably forget that a third of charities in Australia had revenues of less than $50,000 in a year. So they really are at the micro end. Most charities don't employ anyone at all. And if we think about these micro charities, they normally don't have anyone employed. They are just run by volunteers, by those local organizations, and they do an incredibly good work. You know, people say, well, with so many charities and so many small charities, aren't we overdoing it? Aren't we duplicating services? Two-thirds of all charities have revenues of less than 250,000. So shouldn't we combine them all and get some scale benefit? You know, there's going to be more efficiency if we're not duplicating services. No, that's not the case at all. Firstly, these charities are meeting the local community. They might be a little group raising awareness or supporting people in that local geographical area or for that particular sport or for that particular community group. And so the big scale is not going to have that nuance, that connection with the local charities. Secondly, the small charities have really good efficiency. As I said, they're not really employing anyone. They're getting by just by volunteer support and service. And in fact, if we look at those small charities, for every person they employ, there are 18 volunteers on average for those micro charities. If we look at the big end of the charities, for every volunteer they have three employees. So that's an expensive way of running their services. The bigger charities are largely delivering services through paid employment. The smaller charities, as I said, hardly any employees, 18 times as many volunteers as employees. So they really deliver it through volunteer service. So that makes them low cost, very efficient, and connected with their local communities. I mean, at the largest end, just to remind ourselves, what are the big charities? The universities in Australia are charities, and you've got the University of Sydney at the top of the list there. It receives more than $2 billion from government money each year, or the University of Melbourne, not far off the pace, University of Queensland, billions of dollars going to them. Now, that's important because they meet the needs and educate tens of thousands of students each through these degrees, so important charities. But that's the size at the bigger end, and then you've got these tiny charities, $8,000, $10,000, $20,000 a year, meeting the local needs and not receiving any government support at all. Another thing I found interesting is that of all of the revenues that charities receive, if you total it all up, just 7% is through the donations of people. A far bigger category is through actually fees for services or selling a product. So they're not for profits, but they're still engaged in commerce, in business. But they if they make a profit, that goes back into what they do, into their bigger cause. And even bigger than the third of revenues coming through goods and services is half of all revenues from government, as the government distributes money for the local charities to meet the service obligations of, as government outsources a lot of those welfare programs to charities or education, and as the government supports these charities as well. So most of the money that they receive in total comes from the government. Now, that's particularly at the larger end. The micro charities are just getting by through volunteer service and a little bit of donations, some GoFundMes here and there. But the scale of the charities, the smaller end and the impacts they have, and the fact that it's not just about donations alone, but it's about volunteer service and the other revenue streams, that's probably what's a big surprise for us as we look at the charity sector in this nation.
Yeah, it's really interesting to hear that. I don't even know if I was aware that the University of Sydney was technically a not-for-profit, and it makes sense to me, but you don't think that. I think of the big charities like the Salvation Army or the RSPCA, but we're actually talking at a bigger scale when we're talking about universities, which I guess correlates to some of those sources of revenue being government there. But it's amazing to see as well and to hear about those micro charities and how many organizations don't have maybe as much capacity, but they're punching way above their weight with their output and their impact. So hopefully, again, this report is something that those organisations can draw upon and feel encouraged by as we seek to understand Australians and people in general, their perspective towards how they choose to give. And it's great to see even on that infographic page that I mentioned that 4 in 5 Australians give financially to charities or not-for-profits in some capacity. So that's great to see that we're still a generous nation in some ways, depending on whatever that looks like, maybe more people than we've seen in that statistic here are, you know, volunteering, but in terms of giving financially in some way, 4 in 5, which is pretty high, I guess, and good to see, very encouraging. So it's good. I think something else that, you know, as I said, we've conducted this study for a long time, and we've run an event to share these insights in person in history, you know, in a few recent years. And now we do that online to try and have greater reach and greater impacts with this research. But something that I always have found quite interesting, and you even alluded to it earlier, Mark, was the causes that people are motivated to give to. And it's been interesting to see over time how some of those causes have risen and how some have declined. I was keen to maybe hear from you, Mark, if you could share with our listeners what our research suggests are the top causes that people are preferring to give to at the moment. And if you see these, I guess, changing over time, and if you can make any correlations around what impacts people to change, say, a cause, or what motivates, or what we think motivates a cause to move up the list, say, of importance for Australians.
Yeah, well, that's spot on, Ash. It does go up and down depending on the circumstances, the context that we're in. Take, for example, disaster relief. That's number 6 on the list at the moment because we've had a few blessed years where we haven't had as many natural disasters here locally, nor even in our part of the world. And so that's dropped down a little bit. We saw just a few years ago, it was the number 1, and before that, number 2, as we had bushfires and floods and disasters in the region. So Aussies are happy to open their wallet to get online and to donate to disaster relief when the need arises. But to see that drop down the list is actually a good thing. We see the environment go up and down depending on where Australians are at in terms of their worries about environmental issues. And that's down the list a little bit at the moment. At the top of the list, and it does always stay in the top 5, is medical research and cancer organisations. And Australians recognise that we need to invest into that and they need to give money to solve that. Everyone has been touched by a cancer story or a survivor who's been through a medical challenge, or maybe they've dealt with a loss in that regard. So Australians recognise that they need to support that. They've been touched by it. And at the micro end, you've got a lot of causes and charities in response to someone losing a loved one or someone needing to battle through a tough time. And so they're giving to research in that regard. This taps into what we're discussing earlier, the big charities and why we need them, those universities, those big hospitals, those big medical research organizations, because that can't be done by a little local community group. They can't run the research programs to find a cure for some of these cancers or illnesses. So that's at the top of the list at the moment. Children's charities come in second, and that's largely those big charities, but you've got a lot of small charities as well that make a difference for local children and young people. So that's second. And then animal welfare comes in third, supporting those animals. Our fourth one that's really risen up the list strongly of recent years is mental health. And again, that just tells us a lot about the awareness, the issues that we've all seen, far more focus on that and more recognition of mental well-being and the importance of that. And if you think about that, you know, Australians give based on unfortunate circumstances. You know, you can't help help cancer and medical issues. So we want to support that. Children need a fair go in life. Animals, we've got to look after them. And mental health, we've all been touched by it. And that's where Australians give. It's interesting looking at the bottom of the list, and often it's around local poverty that's not being solved, because Australians are saying, well, the government's there. Now, they're not always there in every way for that, but that's low down on the list. Political causes, Australians don't give too much to. They say, well, that's politics. We want to give where we really see the needs. Prison resource, so those meeting the needs of prisoners. Again, Australians put that a little lower on the list because they say, well, you know, you got to take responsibility. So it's just interesting how Australians give. Now, not all those attitudes are true and correct, and people still give to those causes that are lower down. But cancer, children, animals, mental health, they dominate at the moment, and they have risen up the ranks of recent years.
Yeah, it's interesting to see what is relevant, well, not relevant, but what people perceive to be the most relevant causes and how they change over time, like you said, Mark, as a result of the context. And I do remember, I think it was early 2020, after we just had that really horrendous bushfire season here in Australia, that we saw that disaster response really rise, because it was just flooding our news feeds and everybody was aware of the impacts, and there was big relief concerts, you know, to help people who'd been impacted, who'd lost homes. So all those different things, the context plays a role in that. But I guess the challenge for many organizations who are trying to do consistent, you know, good work. And technically, I guess, like you mentioned it earlier as well, like it's a good thing to see, I guess, that we don't have a lot of disasters to respond to at the moment. Like that's a good thing to be a good thing to point out. But there's still organizations and charities who are trying to do that good work and maybe not have an immediate need, and it's not felt as much, but they're still trying to kind of, help people or organizations or situations who are kind of, more consistent. So it's interesting to see that tension there.
Yeah, and there's been a change with the next generation coming through in that regard, where the next generation are saying, we want to give not just to immediate needs, but to deal with root causes. We want to give so that we can solve the problem and build resilience, not just give when there's an immediate challenge before us. And that's where disaster relief actually shifts from, you know, responding to the flood or the crisis to actually helping communities be resilient, helping those in poverty, particularly overseas, solve some of those root causes. So that's an interesting trend, this trend away from immediate need to root cause solving and even awareness raising and resilience preparedness. Young people are giving more to that longer term view. And they're also more likely to give to global causes, not just local ones. So we've constantly found that traditionally Australians have said, you got to look after your own backyard first, and then you look beyond, and the neighbour begins at home. Australians are happy to sort out and solve and give to international problems and disasters, but they definitely prioritise local needs. But that's changing as well, where the younger generation are a global generation, and they're saying, well, actually, global issues matter, and sometimes the crisis faced overseas is greater than that on our own shores. And so they're happy to have that broader global view than just the local one. So there's some of the long-term trends that we'll see change. Giving to refugee needs and human rights and poverty alleviation overseas, far higher for younger people than older people. And this is part of the generational shifts that we're tracking.
Yeah, I definitely think that's one thing that stood out to me in this most recent study, was that, it was the shift away from, because we used to always have that messaging around Australians want to look after their own backyard first, but it really seems to be changing with the generations coming through in this regard. So it's interesting to see that. I think, you know, thinking about the longer term trends is really important, and we've seen some of that, as you just mentioned, Mark. But I think also what's fascinating is to think about the immediate context, and when we think about that, and we were, you know, considering this as we wrote this survey and conducted this study, was the immediate context that's having an impact on people's time, but also, I guess, their finances. And we can't really look past at the moment, I guess, the impacts of the rising interest rates and the cost of living. I actually saw something online recently in the news, which was saying that Lifeline has had a marked increase in the number of people calling about their mental health because of the impact of the cost of living, those households that don't have as much buffer, and then rising costs and the impact there. So not only, I guess, on particular causes and charities or not-for-profits that help those, but just Australians or people in general, the capacity they maybe feel to give when, you know, wallets get a bit thinner and restrictions happen with regards to how much there is discretionary spend going on. We did actually investigate this. So I wanted to ask you, Mark, do you think the changing economic landscape is having an impact on people's giving behaviour at the moment?
It is. And as you just shared, that's the real challenge. There's a double challenge because as financial challenges rise, the demand for these services increases, but the resources through giving decreases. So it really does create more of a stretch. The same, you mentioned, you know, the rise in people seeking mental health support and other service support. And yet at the same time, over the last couple of years, we've noticed it now, volunteering has declined. So again, demand higher, supply of those volunteer hours lower. And partly that was lockdowns and partly as people have had to pick up extra work and do other things or move locations that haven't been as available as in the past. So we asked in this study at the start of this year, we asked to what extent has cost of living and housing prices impacted your ability and willingness to give. And on the ability to give, almost half, 45% of people said it's decreased their ability to give, the cost of living. Hardly anyone said it's increased, and a good amount said it's unchanged. But people were three times more likely to say, actually, my ability to give has decreased than has increased. And then we asked a follow-up question, well, what about your willingness to give? Has that changed? Now, you wouldn't expect just because it's tougher financially, people are less willing to give. But actually what we found is that a third of people said actually they're less willing to give now. They were twice as likely to say less willing than more willing. And the question is, why is that? I mean, they might be unable to give, but why less willing to give? Because they're actually starting to say, I'm actually reorientating my finances and my budget now. And while I've had that regular giving and I've been willing to give, now I've got to just set the budget up in a different way. So I'm just not, for the moment, as willing to give. And we find this consistently in our research that consumer sentiment leads to consumer behavior change. As we start to have fears or anxieties around the economics, it starts to actually change what we do in our spend. And this is true for charities as well. So as the economic uncertainties continue, as the cost of living and inflation pressures roll on, people actually start to change their giving behavior, not just in the immediate term, in terms of closing those wallets, as you said, but in terms of even starting to change and say, well, giving is something I used to do and I might get back to it. But right now, I'm just not willing to invest. So that's a bit of a challenge. And it does raise the communications opportunity for charities to say, get back out there, re-engage, connect up. And even if people aren't able or willing to give at the moment, surely they're going to support your charity through advocacy, through volunteering, through perhaps non-monetary means. Maybe you can just keep engaged with them, and when their financial circumstances change, they'll get back there. Or maybe they can't give money, but they can donate some goods. They can donate perhaps some points, some frequent flyer points or other things. There are other ways to give beyond just the financial. And it's about engaging. Keep the connection up, because when the good times roll back or when the tough times ease, if you've kept that relationship with that donor, they'll be back on board for the long term. They don't want to break the connection with the charity. So keep the relationship and communication strong.
Yeah, some really great advice there for this tough economic time for citizens in general, but also charities who rely on those citizens to give time and money, for sure. I think it's interesting as well to think about this in this era of declining trust. We've been talking about this for a couple of years now, I guess through various royal commissions and just a general decline in trust across a few different areas of society, like the media and government and not-for-profits. That's just been a trend that we've been observing. But we wanted to, I guess, test this in this most recent study and to navigate or investigate rather where people and Australians are at. How do they view charities and not-for-profits? What's the level of trust? Was there anything that stood out to you, Mark, with regards to some of the insights here that we garnered around this idea of trust in the not-for-profit sector?
Yeah, this was fascinating. And we asked Australians to rate their level of trust in all manner of organisations, from charities to different layers of government, to government enterprises, to big corporates, to local businesses. And we just tracked those who gave a 7 or 8 or 9 or 10 out of 10, so high trust. And if we look at the proportion of Australians who say they have high trust in the charities of their world, it's more than two-thirds of Australians, or almost two-thirds, 62%. I mean, that was fantastic. So So most Australians, 2 in 3, say they've got a high level of trust in charities. That was twice the proportion that said they've got a trust in big corporates. And we're dealing with big corporates all the time, you know, big telcos or maybe big brands that we buy from or we buy their products. They're twice as likely Australians to say they have a high trust in charities than in corporates. So that's an amazing benefit, a brand benefit that charities have. They're highly trusted. And that was in the highest category. The only other category that was equal to charities was small businesses. So that's fascinating to keep in mind. People trust charities, whether they be big or whether they be local, and they trust those local businesses as well, the local baker, the local shopping or retail supplier that they go to, because they've got that relational connection. They know the barber or they connect with the butcher. They know the name of the local barista where they go for that coffee. And so highly trusted at a local level. We're highly trusting our charities, less so the governments, organisations, and even at the bottom of the list are the corporates. So that's something to keep in mind. I think charities have that level of trust. They can capitalise on that trust, and they can avoid the trust doom loop that we've tracked a little bit. And that often comes where there's been a misuse of money, a lack of integrity, a lack of transparency or communication. If we haven't been as accountable in giving back to the volunteers or the donors information around what we're doing, where we're spending that money on, that's why we have the easing of that trust. But if we're clear on the communication, we're highlighting what we're doing with the money, we're doing those social impact reporting, showing where the money is going, showing the impact, showing what we're doing, we've got the clear governance. People can go to the website, see who's on the board, see who the senior staff are. They've got access to our policies, to what we're about. We've got the annual reports up there. We're on the ACNC with our charities there. All of that metrics and information is there. We'll be in the frame of the 2/3 of Australians who say, hey, highly trust that charity, and that's the place to be.
Yeah, it's really encouraging to see that that's a really high proportion of the population that have a high level of trust in not-for-profits. And like you said, Mark, just there, as a result of the great work that these not-for-profits and charities are doing, not just on the ground and to further their cause, but also to, I guess, respond to this, what we call expectation inflation, that, you know, I think particularly when we're talking about not-for-profits, people are giving out of their hard-earned money or time, and they have an expectation that that is being used for the intended purpose. And so it's great to see that charities have done well with this, like you said, you know, social impact reporting, which we investigated. That was the topic of our study last year, and we had some insights around that. But yeah, it's also fascinating to compare how well charities and not-for-profits are compared to other areas of society like media and government. And also, as you were sharing there, Mark, just those, you know, local charities, local businesses, I wonder also, because I've seen a lot of our research even just the last few years that we've been sharing about, you know, the return to local and the impact from the pandemic, that we've had this kind of get to know your local business and support local. So that's not surprising there that that's also, there's a lot of trust and relationship that's been developed in light of that. So it's great to see. And I think, as I mentioned there, you know, we do hold not-for-profits and charities in a high regard, but we also have high expectations, and trust is a really fragile thing, as we know. And we explored that too in the research around the trust, but also what could impede trust or what could block people from engaging with a not-for-profit. What were the most significant blockers that we uncovered, Mark, around this, and what's important for charities to, you know, keep in mind when we're talking about things that could prevent people from supporting them?
Well, we're talking largely about donors who are giving money or giving time, and they are giving therefore sacrificially. So they want to make sure that any of that giving of time or money is going to a good cause and going to an organization that's going to make the most of that and is having some real impact. And so the financial accountability and transparency is number one, and the impact transparency is number two. Now, that second area is a newer one. You know, people would just, someone would rattle the can, people would put the change in and say, hey, I trust that organization, they're going to do good things. But Australians are a bit more sophisticated now, and they're saying, okay, I will give you money or time because I trust and recognize this brand, and I know you've been around for a long time. But I want to know that actually you are having some impacts because you've been at this cause or this issue for a long time. We want to know that actually you're getting some wins out there. You're solving the problem for individuals, or you're slowly solving the cause for which you exist. And that's where social impact reporting is important. That's where communicating the outcomes of the money or the programs that are being supported matters, and showing the wins, the awareness raised, the solutions, the outcomes. Hopefully there's some sort of dashboard where we can show here's the impacts that we've made there, or the solutions that we've brought about because of your donation, a direct impact of the giving through to the solving of that situation. That's what Australians want to see, and that sophisticated level of reporting in terms of impact reporting is where it's got to. But obviously most charities are doing this well because two-thirds are in the highly rated category, or two-thirds of Australians highly rate charities in terms of trust. And that comes against a backdrop where there are from time to time scandals around charities in terms of maybe where the money has gone, or in terms of perhaps some historical matters that have come up through royal commissions. The resilience, though, of the charities brands individually, but also the brand as a whole of not-for-profits is very strong, because even though there's the odd issue that might emerge, generally charities are doing the right thing, and Australians say, no, we back you, we're with you, and we know that you're fair income around it. So keep communicating, keep engaging, keep being transparent in that information, and that will keep charities in the good stead in the minds of Australians.
Yeah, absolutely. It was interesting to see as well, like you just shared, the most significant blocker for people to decide to get involved with a charity or not-for-profit is around that mismanagement of finances. And finances is a really important part of running an organisation, whether it be a not-for-profit or not. But when we're talking about this industry and this sector specifically, there's been this idea for a long time, according to my understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong, that not-for-profits and charities should only be keeping their administration costs below 20%. And I was overhearing you talk about this recently, Mark, and again, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that maybe this somehow started within the not-for-profit sector. And I can understand, I guess, as a consumer or as someone who supports a not-for-profit, why people want that, because they want the majority of the incoming money to be going to the need or the cause directly. But I think the more I understand about business is that, you know, it's really important to have great admin processes and structures set up. And if you're nailing that, hopefully then donations just continue to rise. So there's always that tension. And we did investigate even this, but is that correct, Mark? Have I understood that idea that it kind of began in the not-for-profit sector, and now maybe people are wondering, oh, should we have really communicated this so much? Because they're a little bit bound by that expectation.
Well, that's exactly right. And it goes back some decades. And maybe there was a question in some people's minds as to how much of the money I'm giving is actually going through to the program, going through to have an impact, and how much is really used up on overheads and staff costs and perhaps admin and fundraising and marketing and all of that. And so many in the industry started to have this metric, the percentage that goes directly to the program or to the impacts versus the proportion that is on admin or on overheads. And the 80-20 rule emerged, 80% having the impacts, at least 80%, and 20% or less on overhead costs became the metric that emerged, the best practice, just as charities put this number forward. Well, Australians have picked up on that, and this is true right around the world. And the 80-20 has become not just a benchmark, but a rule that donors expect to see maintained. It becomes almost something that cannot be violated. Overhead costs, admin costs, marketing and administration costs must be below 20%. So we put this to Australians, and we even put a scenario. We said, well, let's say by extending the overhead costs maybe outside of that 20%, they could actually use that marketing, that advertising to gain more in total dollar terms, more money that could therefore have a bigger impact. In other words, maybe by breaking out of the 20% overhead, maybe if we got it to 25 or 30%, that could raise many more dollars. You know, if we have a $5 for every $1 invested return, then the more we invest in overhead, actually, the greater the return and the bigger the impact on what we're about. If a charity did that, what do we think? And only 33% of Australians said, okay, grow the overall, if you can grow the overall donations by breaking out of that 20% overhead metric, then we're fine with that. The vast majority, 67%, said no. Even if that was the case, keep your overheads at 20% or less, because that's what we value. That's what we want to see, where for every dollar that gets consumed by the charity, four times that goes to the cause. That's where we feel comfortable. So 67% say, hey, keep marketing, admin costs, your overheads below at 20% or below. That, therefore, is where the public has settled. So even though charities brought this up as a bit of a metric that they shared, the public has now picked it up and they're going to keep charities accountable to that. So the 80-20 rule is here to stay, and I think it's best practice now. And even when you look at charities being ranked, when you look at these charity watch type services where they look at accountability of charities, if they've got one figure to put up there, that's the one. How much of the total revenues is spent on overheads? And if it's 20% or less, it gets the green tick. And so I would encourage charities to stick with that because the public have accepted that as a good benchmark.
Yeah, it's really interesting and a really great takeaway, I think, for anyone listening who might be involved with a not-for-profit in some way. As we think about this and the not-for-profit sector moving forward in light of all of these insights, and there's so much more in the report and the infographic that we haven't even touched on in the episode today, in light of all of this and remaining relevant for the future, do you have any advice, Mark, for not-for-profits, in addition to the great insight you just shared there, I guess, around, in light of all of this, you know, looking to remain relevant for the future, do you have any tips or advice for anyone listening who might be involved in a not-for-profit?
Well, it is back to maintaining and communicating those standards, just the expectations of what we would expect as public. You know, the front of the newspaper test or the pub test, as we say in Australia, does this pass the pub test? So if a charity, whether they be big or whether they're a micro charity, of which most are, as we said, and we know almost all of them are doing a good job, they're zealous in what they're about, they're sincere in their purpose, they're based on volunteering, on donations, they're not about a way to make money. In fact, most people working in the charity sector could earn a lot more if they worked for a for-profit company. So they're genuine in why they're there. And because of all of that, make sure that communication of what we're about is clear. The public, whether those charities are big or small, expects those charities to be genuine in what they're about and managing that money modestly in the expenses and impactfully in terms of what they're about. So I would just say that's got to be the foundation of what we're about. Issues around money is the number one reason for a breach of trust. And so that's got to be first and foremost. Now, every charity here that we're discussing has to be registered by the Australian Charities Not-for-Profits Commission. They therefore do have to put in an annual information statement. They are accessible on that government website where people can go and look at those charities. And I think that level of accountability is excellent, whether they be big or small. I would say for the bigger ones, they can invest a bit more in delivering those annual social impact reports, on showing the wins that they're achieving, on having the website where we can see the board and the executive. That's the level of disclosure Australians now want to see. They hear about a charity that's doing something, they want to know, well, who's behind the governance of this? Who's keeping this charity accountable? How do we know where the money's going? Let's have a look at that annual report. Now, most Australian donors won't read through the report, but they want to know it's there. They want to know that the board is accessible. They want to know that the charity is accountable. They want to know that they are giving a good account of the money and the opportunities and the benefits that they receive by being a registered charity and the tax benefits that come from that. So financial accountability, whether they be big or small, clear governance and access to those reports on the website and other places, and just keep the faith, you know, keep showing the wins, the innovation, the benefits, the breakthroughs, because that's going to re-engage. Let's not just sail on the benefits of the brand historically, but let's continue to innovate and adapt to make sure we're having wins, not just in the past, but for the future. And that'll maintain the trust of Australians in not only that particular charity, but the sector as a whole. And that will benefit all charities in the sector if we can maintain that trust.
Some really great insights there and some great research and advice. Thank you so much for your time today, Mark, and your expertise and your passion as well for giving back to this sector. It's greatly appreciated.
Thanks, Ash.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, including this latest report and infographic, you can head to mccrindle.com/resources. You can subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or simply head to mccrindle.com to investigate what we've been up to lately. So as always, thank you again for listening and bye for now.